have helped us do a $40 or $50 million deal. That questions integrity of the people who are running the organization when they profit directly from those developments and those who do not. So we wanted to enter into an agreement and work with an entity where they are employees and their board is made up of mayors all around Cuyahoga County and a few other people. So that's how all this came about over the last few years. We have a similar strategy for Hayden. Collect as much land as we can for Hayden. The only way any developer will tell you, and none of these people in here are developers, the hardest part of doing development is land acquisition. They got 30, they can raise the money, they can get the equipment, they can find the residents, but they can't acquire the land. And we did that very successfully. And we didn't publicize it because we don't want people to run out and try to buy a lot here and buy a lot there, so on and so forth. We prevented that from happening. As a matter of fact, there's a gentleman here who owns a piece of property who has been trying to market his piece of property for years. Now, if in fact the land bank in the city is successful in marketing four streets to be redeveloped, that means his project can get done. That'll take development from Lakeview all the way up to Superior. Everybody's been asking for, well, where's the development plan? Where's the development plan? Where's the development plan? We've been planning to do a development, work with a developer for years, but we have to find the right partner. Now, contained in that agreement that everybody's so afraid of is, one, if in 5 years they can't market the land, then it comes back to the city of East Cleveland. Now, say, for example, if I'm bamboozling, I'm saying, hey, you know, forget the developer, we're gonna put pig farms in. The power of this body right here, the only way anything can be built on a piece of vacant land is if they get a conditional use permit. The only entity in East Cleveland that can give a conditional use permit is the city council. So there's an expiration on the agreement. If the land and what we say it's to be used for isn't used that way, you can stop it every time they bring it to you until the agreement runs out and the land reverts back to the city of East Cleveland. That's the law. That is the law. You're the only body that can give a conditional use. The only way you can build something is to have a conditional use.
5 minutes.
Joe, please.
Now, please. About this placement of people, I don't know if you've been in that area lately. In some cases, the majority of the residents live in Cleveland because people believe from Forest Hills Avenue to Euclid, from Lakeview all the way up to Brightwood, is all East Cleveland. It is not. The majority of the houses that are left are in Cleveland. That has nothing to do with us. Now, there are some people who still live in that area that live in East Cleveland, and if they choose not to leave, then they choose not to leave. There definitely will be an offer on their property so that you can do a complete development, but you can't take their land because in East Cleveland, there is no eminent domain. The only entity that can go into a community with the authority to do eminent domain in a city that doesn't have, that doesn't allow for you to take anything from eminent domain is a public utility. That's the only entities out there, the public utilities. But a private developer, a quasi-government organization that wants to do private development cannot initiate eminent domain in a community where there is no eminent domain. Now, say, for example, if someone wants to move, by federal law, if you do a development that large, you have to have assistance for them to get from point A to point B. You just don't buy them out, tear their house down, and they just stuck. You have to provide them assistance to move somewhere else. Now, if you've ever been on Brightwood, if you've ever been on Penrose, almost anywhere is better than living on that street. They live there because they have to, not because they want to. And most of the homeowners are underwater in their mortgage, and they can't move. If they could move, they would have moved. They would have sold their homes a long time ago.
Please address that.
So,
Can we please address
who are you there?
This,
I live on Terrace. I live around the corner from you, Smedley.
Chief of staff, please.
So, out your window today, it is because the failure of our government to take action. And some individuals in this room served in council where action should have been taken, and it never was. The post office in Cleveland Heights where you work is because the city refused to take action. Euclid Corridor stopped at University Circle because the city refused to take action. RTA was going to put the only hydrogen station in the state of Ohio, state of the art. People from around the world will come and see this thing in East Cleveland, and we stopped it. We have done nothing to move the city forward, period. The only breath of fresh air, the only changes that have occurred is when you three were elected to council. That's the only time things have changed. There's been no change. No change. Only thing that we've had in the last, I don't know how many years, and everybody in this room can attest to it, is you pit council against the mayor and nothing happens. All you get is arguing and bickering. Decade after decade after decade. That's why our streets look like that. Now, this agreement only allows for the land bank to market our property. Yes, if I'm bamboozling you,
yes, you are.
You have the final authority. If they say, hey, we're going to build pig farms, they got to come and get a conditional use. They say if they want to build multi-million dollar homes, they got to come and get a conditional use. If they want to build mixed-use buildings, they got to come and get a conditional use. And that's city council, the only authority that can give a conditional use.
I have a question for you regarding that. As far as the oversight and the redevelopment, that's when the MOA is a general outline. The developer agreement is the more specifics as far as where who multi-age, multi-use. Exactly. So that way, through council, the public will be able to have.
So this is how it works. The MOU allows them to gain access to land. No one is going to spend $100,000 to do a market study. No real developer is going to come and develop in an area without a market study. You're not going to use last year's market study. You're not going to use the market study that Circle East used 5 years ago. You want an up-to-date market study, and you want to spend close to $100,000, if not over, depending upon which consultant you use. No one's going to spend that on the thought of possibly getting access to land. So once they do that, the developers come in. They do the plan. They say, this is what we want this area to look like. That design must go through three bodies. The Board of Zoning Appeals to zone the areas and they get a variance. Architectural review so that it has consistent architecture. And then the final thing that they have to come through after they do all of that work and spend all of that money, they have to come back to City Council and ask for a conditional use. And you can say at any point in this, this is what we want in our developer's agreement. You want to know why they will comply? Because they know that in 5 years they would have to get the land back and you can hold out for 5 years by not allowing them to have a conditional use. Unfortunately, the decision that you make today and allowing this to occur, future councils will hold it up and a development may not occur. If someone is recalled or if there's a new election or any of that, that person will come in and hold it up, have the power to hold it up. Me explaining it to you, you know, that's how they would use that power. But you have that authority.
Is it all right?
It's the law. I am comfortable with it.
Are there any other questions you have?
Any other questions?
Because we talked extensively, and I was able to understand the whole purpose of the entering into the agreement with the mayor. A lot of people have a problem with that, but the mayor is the only one that can actually sign the contract.
Right.
So understand that.
Can I add to that? The committee that you put together, now you're passing in the law saying that, hey, this stuff has to be approved by the committee. We couldn't even transfer the property now because you would have to approve that transfer. Parcel by parcel,
right,
with this new language that you add.
Right.
Parcel by parcel must be approved.
Right. Okay.
So it has constant oversight.
Constant oversight.
So you're good, Council President? I'm
fine with that. I have a clear understanding of it. And just on a note, side note, nobody gave me a dime art. I'm not doing this for no money. I'm not doing this for a backroom deal. I don't know what anybody else is doing it for. But I'm straightforward about what I'm doing.
Bess Smedley can't say that.
But I'm talking about my man.
Okay, all right. Bess Smedley can't say that.
So I'll take it.
I also have a good feel for what's what you're going on. And just for the record,
I'm not going to get off.
This is the second read on this. We've already read this into the record before. We've discussed this at length. This is the second read. Council clerk, Dr. Guy, would you kindly call the roll?
You don't have no water.
Discussion in public. No discussions. Council Graham?